Contender for the presidency. Another contender, Senator Oscar W. Underwood of Alabama, was so convinced that the Klan was contrary to all principles of democracy that he wanted the convention to denounce the Klan in no uncertain terms. His political courage would be tested during that fateful summer of 1924.
Senator Underwood intends to make the Ku Klux Klan an issue at this convention. Is that true?
Well, now, Bill, I only manage Senator's campaign. I don't...
And I tell you that if Oscar Underwood makes the Klan an issue at this convention, he will not only rend the Democratic Party in half, but he may precipitate a religious holocaust.
Bill, Oscar Underwood's never been charged with being irresponsible.
Yes, but the presidential bug can inflict a mighty deep wound on a man. Now, you and I know that this is probably the last chance that Underwood will have at the nomination. He's a dark horse in a desperate race. Such a man might be provoked into the greatest gambles. Making the Klan an open issue is a great gamble. A gamble that could bring our party down in flaming ruins and light the fires of a religious holocaust.
I will certainly tell the senator what you said, Bill. Now listen to me all. I want you to remember two numbers. The 1,098 votes at this convention. If any candidate to get the nomination, he needs 732 votes at the absolute minimum. Now, some of you know the arithmetic pretty well. Some of you don't. But no one, I repeat that, no one can work effectively unless these two numbers are written across his mind. Now, I have absolutely no conscience about nagging you on this subject. Come on in, friend. Take a chair over there. Sit right down. Now, as of this moment, no one can come into this convention with that many votes. Not Smith, not McAdoo, not Cox, not Ralston.
Not Oscar Underwood.
You're right, lady, and not Oscar W. Underwood. If all a candidate needed was a simple majority, which is 550 votes, I'd simply tell you all to go out and get a drink and forget about it, because Oscar Underwood would have no chance at this convention. Either McAdoo or Smith could pick up that 550 in three or four ballots. And if this convention were run on a simple majority like the Republican convention, I'd bet, if I were a betting man, it could be over in 3 days. And if I were a betting man, I'd bet on McAdoo, not Smith. But the peculiar arithmetic of the Democratic Party requires that a candidate get two-thirds and not a simple majority. Now, the difference between these two figures is 182 votes. Well, brothers and sisters, those 182 votes are going to look as far off as the fields of heaven before this convention is over. So this convention is going to boil down to arithmetic and stay in power. Now, wait a minute. I'm going to tell you something else. There is a bad smell of oil on the White House. You get that? teapot dome oil. Presidency can go to the Democratic Party this year. That's why everyone in his kid brother's after it. That's why McAdoo wants it. And that's why we want it. For Senator Oscar W. Underwood.
Yay!
That's the kid. Give it up. Believe me, we're all right. And they're not going to nominate somebody they think will fumble the ball. So you can bet your bottom dollar, Al Smith is out of the running. I know. Everybody in this town says Al Smith for president. Well, folks, don't you forget you're in Governor Smith's backyard. And you'll be hearing Smith from every cab driver and bartender and bellhop in this town. But don't you forget the two-thirds requirement. And Al Smith has no chance of getting two-thirds. Not in the first ballot, not in the third, not in the fifth, not in the tenth, or on the 20th.
20 ballots? Well, I don't see how we could last that long. I mean, after all, Madison Square Garden isn't the coolest place in New York.
No, it is the hottest, madam. And if you'll excuse me, it is going to get hotter than the hinges of Hades. People are going to sweat and ladies are going to faint. And everybody's going to get the worst case of heat rash the world has seen since the Israelites followed Moses in the desert. But right then, folks, is when you've got to hold on to your people. Because when the votes start switching to break the deadlock, that's when we'll start collecting delegates, and that's when we're going to win!
Yay!
Wait one minute! Ladies and gentlemen, the Democratic nominee and the next president of the United States, Oscar W. Underwood!
Hi! How are you? Happy to see you. Please sit down, ladies and gentlemen. We've got a long pull ahead of us, and if you start popping to attention every time I come into a room, you'll make me as shy as a deer, and you'll wear yourselves out. Now, I am conscious of the fact that you people have put up a hard fight for my candidacy, and that you face an even longer and harder fight at the convention. Now, if Charlie will forgive the heresy, it doesn't much matter if I'm nominated at this convention.
Oh, now, Oscar.
Please, I am very serious about this. At this convention, we have a mission to perform, which is quite apart from any political ambitions that I may have. Our mission is to see that the Democratic Party condemns the Ku Klux Klan and everything it represents. Now, in almost every primary that I entered, I was defeated because of my attacks on the Klan. But I feel more strongly than ever that the Ku Klux Klan is the single most important issue of this convention and of this election. I don't want Mr. McAdoo or any other candidate to duck this issue. We have got to drag it out of the platform committee and onto the floor in full sight of every delegate. Now, a moment will come, ladies and gentlemen, in this convention, when every delegate will have to declare publicly whether he approves the Klan or not.
Senator, since many of us are Catholics, we feel it might be a mistake to make the Klan the issue.
I respect your feelings, madam, and I understand your motives. But I came to this convention not solely to be nominated. If we do nothing here but place our party on record against the Klan, I can go home to Alabama with the feeling I've won, whether the arithmetic works for me or not.
Yeah. Excuse me, please, folks. Senator, Governor Brandon waiting to see you.
Oh, now thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your loyalty and your support.
And thank you, folks, for coming in. You just circulate around now and keep your ears open. We get together before the convention comes to order. Go ahead, see the senator. And to the gentleman, for the love of Mike, stay sober or stay in your room. We want everybody having William Jennings Bryan say, for instance, we're running a bootleggers convention. All right, thank you, boys. Excuse me. Madam, excuse us, please. Fine, thank you.
Senator, we got trouble.
Brandon?
What is it? Think he's a little scared of our nominating speech. Think there's own political skin back in Alabama.
Bill, good to see you.
Governor, you look fine, Senator.
Thank you. Sit down. Well, Bill, what do you think of the speech?
Oh,
Come on, Bill, out with it.
Senator.
Don't you like it?
Senator, I consider it an honor to place your name in nomination, believe me. But... Oh, Charlie, I thought you would explain it to the senator.
I told you on the phone, Governor, that part of the speech has to stay in. The part naming the Klan.
It's unacceptable to me, Oscar. I told Charlie that it was. I thought you might delete it.
No, Bill, I won't.
Then I'll have to decline the honor of placing your name in nomination. I'm sorry, Oscar. Believe me. Of course, my vote and the entire Alabama delegation is pledged to you. I promise you we won't let you down.
What are you afraid of, Bill? I presume it's fear of the Klan. Of course, I wouldn't entertain the idea that you might be a member.
I wouldn't be that generous, Senator.
How dare you, Charlie?
Bill, please, let's act like grown-ups. I'm disappointed, Bill. Deeply so. I thought as governor of my state and leader of the delegation and a close friend that, well, it seemed quite fitting.
If you can't see the Klan issue as a matter of principle, then let's think of it in terms of politics. I am not considered a liberal. I am considered a Southern candidate. Now, these two marks are pretty bad ones in this convention. I've got to overcome them. Now, any Southerner who is not afraid to fight the Klan will get the Northern liberal vote.
No. McAdoo won't let that Klan issue get to the floor. He'll kill it in the platform committee, and you'll be left with a mark that'll ruin you for political life. The man who fought the Klan. I don't want to share that mark with you, Senator. Sorry.
I can see you're not very happy.
You started out swinging the wildcat with a tail, Oscar. Maybe you better let go. We picked up nothing but a lot of bad scratches for our trouble.
We knew that when we started, Charlie. And those scratches are going to get deeper and uglier. But that wildcat will be a pretty handy weapon to use against McAdoo.
All right, Oscar. We've been going on the assumption that an open break in the party over the Klan will harm McAdoo in the convention, but unless we can get the platform committee to bring up a strong plank against the Klan, we can't even get the issue on the floor.
It's your job to see that the platform committee does bring out a strong plank.
But McAdoo's people can outvote us in that committee, Oscar.
They can't prevent you from expressing your opinion, even if it's a minority opinion. As a last resort, take it on the floor of the convention as a dissent or minority plank. But one way or another, Charlie, you get that wildcat into Madison Square Garden and throw it vile and stinking on that rostrum. You losing faith, Charlie?
Brandon was scared of the Klan issue. Maybe too many of them are scared.
Well, if that's true, let's find it out. I am the only candidate who can run with a strong platform plank against the Klan. If the convention will adopt a strong plank, they'll have to come along with me in voting on the nomination. McAdoo can't afford to alienate the Klan votes. He needs them. Smith can't get them.
The Klan votes could stop you.
I don't think there are enough of them, Charlie. But even if there were 500 Klan votes in the garden, they can't be held together in a block indefinitely. Once the convention starts swinging against the Klan, we'll get our two-thirds, Charlie. Well, I sure hope you're right, Oscar.
Yeah, I'm the Underwood's got about as much chance as Peg a Bear to Polish
women. Hey, I'm Polish.
Well, no kidding. You play cards the same way.
Underwood's trouble is he's a Southerner. The Democrats have never elected a Southerner.
What do you mean, never? What was Jefferson Davis, a Republican?
You know what happened to him.
Yeah. What do you mean, what happened to him? The South lost the war, that's all.
In addition to being a lousy card player, you're also a Southerner.
And Polish.
Underwood was cooked when he tackled the Klan. You can't beat those good old cross burners. They're the salt of the earth.
They say there are over 600 Klansmen at the convention.
Let me tell you, brother, if I ever give up newspaper work, I'm going into the white sheet business. It's going to boom.
Thought you were going to be a bootlegger.
Sideline.
Bullies and bigots and flying bedsheets, yes.
Scourge them from the land. Pour a disinfectant on them like you would on some excrescence. But that's not what this convention has been brought to do. It's been brought to nominate a candidate to win an election, not to condemn the Ku Klux Klan. Now, you may hate the Klan as I do, and so may the man who gets the nomination, but he needs to get elected, and he'll need the votes of Klan members to do it.
Does winning really mean that much to the party?
Oh, Charlie, you're too old a political horse to ask a question like that. The first thing any politician's got to do is get elected. Whatever else he manages to do is splendid redundancy.
Wait a minute, Homer. Your trouble is that you have too much sense of responsibility to the party and not enough to yourself as a man.
Of course that's my trouble, General. Why do you think they trusted me to be chairman?
Mr. Forney Johnston, who is placing Senator Oscar Underwood's name in nomination, has paused at the moment. There seems to be considerable activity and caucusing on the floor of the garden. Rumors have it that this speech by Mr. Johnston will include a strong attack on the Ku Klux Klan, which may account for the unusual activity on the floor.
Mr. Johnston still speaking. The candidate of my state has personally requested that I make his position plain, that unless the issue is met, you will not only invite the disintegration of this party, but will take a backward step. The candidate of my state has not one word to advance against the right of any man to join an order, secret or otherwise.
Forney Johnston is going to drop the hook.
Is this the attack on the Klan?
These Alabama boys are winding up for the pitch. Come on, we better get up there. Maybe it's something I can tell my grandchildren.
I feel very strongly about this, Homer.
I couldn't, in good conscience, advise any member of that committee to abandon the naming of the Klan in the party platform.
The Klan will kill the minority plank. They control 300 votes on that convention floor, maybe even more.
They haven't got that kind of strength, Homer.
Then you don't know the size of the enemy you've taken on, Senator. You don't know, or maybe you don't care. Well, I care. There are two planks going before the convention tomorrow, a minority plank and a majority plank. When the Klan kills the minority plank, our party is going to smell of pitch and fire and bigotry. If I thought that the convention would condemn the Klan, I'd fight for the minority plank until I died. But it won't. When the Klan kills the minority plank, we'll look pretty bad in the act. The Republicans never even brought it up.
Matter of fact, it was brought up. As a matter of fact, it was brought up, but it died in the Platform and Resolution Committee. Klan had a smooth operation, killed it there.
It's nothing compared to the operation they've got working here for them. Good night.
Good night, Donald. Do you think he's right, Charlie?
They'll be able to kill our minority plank in a vote? Yes, I think he is right. I think it will be killed by vote. I think they got the votes for it. Remember, Senator, it only takes a simple majority to kill a resolution.
Do you think I'm wrong, Charlie?
Not yet, Senator. All I ask is, if I ever do think you're wrong, you should listen to me.
What's going on in the back of your mind, Charlie?
What do you really feel about the Klan?
What I've said. That it's un-American, un-Christian, something not to be suffered.
The hard arithmetic, Senator, is that Klan votes elect Democrats. Anti-Klan votes don't.
The excitement about the Ku Klux Klan, which was triggered by the nomination of Senator Oscar W. Underwood, has been building.
Attended
now we are in the midst
Christians.
Of a debate. About the
plank of the
party platform, the Ku Klux Klan.
I have been served by Negroes all of my life. They have taken care of me in every way as my servants. And I would despise myself if I wounded the feelings of the humblest Negro in the land. I do not defend the Ku Klux Klan. I think there are some brilliant rascals among them. But I know, too, that there is a great number of good citizens among them who believe in joining the order, that the order was committed to obey and observe and protect the Constitution and the laws of this country. Of the Ku Klux Klan has got us all in his pocket, and I, for one, am going to crawl out of it. The thing for us to determine here this evening is whether the tail wags the dog or the dog wags the tail.
Christ on the cross who said, for they know not what they do. And my friends, we can better exterminate Ku Kluxism by recognizing their honesty and teaching them that they are wrong.
Come in.
I thought you said the senator would be here.
I didn't say that. Just remember.
Look, Colin, I don't talk to messenger boys.
I don't talk to members of the Klan.
Well, maybe it's better this way after all. This way we can talk man to man without involving the senator.
That was my thought.
Mr. Colin, The Knights of the Ku Klux Klan are ready to make your candidate president of the United States. Interested?
I haven't spent 10 months of preparation not to be interested. Go on.
The support of the Klan can go to Senator Underwood if certain conditions are met.
Before we discuss any conditions, how do I know any bargain we'd strike with you be worth our time?
Waste your time?
I believe in figures and mathematics. Just how many votes are you talking about? And I don't mean if votes or maybe votes or perhaps votes. I mean sure votes. I mean votes you can deliver without any explanation or excuses.
Well, that's not something I'm empowered to reveal to you.
There's the telephone. You either get the power to reveal it or get someone over here who can. Or you can just leave the door as you found it when you come in.
I can give it to you in percentages and you can figure it out for yourself. Tell me you're pretty good at that.
Go on.
We control 85% of the Georgia delegation, 80% of the delegations of Arkansas, Kansas, Indiana, and Texas.
Just a minute. Go on.
75% of Mississippi and more than 50% of the Iowa, Kentucky, Michigan, Missouri, Ohio, Tennessee, and West Virginia delegates.
It's about 300 votes. If you can get them all. And that's not even enough to defeat the minority plank, let alone nominate a candidate.
I tell you now, we can deliver over 500 votes to kill the minority plank.
Well, that remains to be seen.
They're voting now. If you want proof that we can deliver what we say, listen to the balloting on the minority plank. I tell you, we'll kill it by a majority, over 500 votes.
Center, right down the middle.
Did they really want me to join the Klan for the nomination?
We didn't get to that. I simply challenged him to deliver any sizable block of votes. Yeah, Kentucky, 14 and 12.
They can, Charlie. That's the real torment of this business. They can deliver a lot of votes on the floor.
Hold it.
Well, if they do, then the Klan is dead as an issue.
No, you're wrong.
Unless I miss my guess very badly, their victory over the minority plank is going to harden the resentment of almost every other delegate here. You know, Charlie, I feel that most men resent the idea of being manipulated. They resent the idea of a secret society running their party, their convention, their country. Part of our problem is convincing these delegates that the Klan is as powerful and as dangerous as we say it is.
Unless they can really whip the plank by a big vote, that's going to be a hard fact to prove.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Louisiana, 10 and 10.
Charlie, listen. If they can't squelch the minority plank, then the party is on record as against the Klan. Now, if they should whip it by a big majority, they've exposed themselves as pawns of the Klan. They're losers either way. There is no third alternative.
Your main, 4... That's 4. Hmm? 7 against.
Rhode Island, 12 votes.
Rhode Island votes, 2 votes against, 10 votes no.
What about it, Harvey? Did the minority plank win or lose?
Wait a minute. Pretty close here. I'm still at it.
Take off your shoes and socks if you need to, Harvey.
Lost by only one vote. That was the third alternative. Just enough for them to win. Not enough to scare or convince.
Yeah, thanks. We'll wait. You haven't touched your food, Senator.
I think I'll go out for a little supper. Thank you.
Mr. Carlin. Have someone remove that, please.
This is the 15th ballot coming up, and this convention shows all the signs of a deadlock.
Gentlemen, Alabama cast 24 votes for Oscar W. Underwood.
Oh, dry up. Well, yeah, it's too hot.
Boy, oh boy. 61 ballots. What are they trying to do? Kill off the contenders? Do you guys realize this is the 4th of July?
Some of those hicks are going home. They've run out of money. After all, the hay and feed store can't run itself forever.
You know what they're going to do tomorrow? We're going to get the managers of those 16 candidates together and start knocking heads.
15 of the 16 candidates have agreed that each candidate, release all of his delegates of any personal pledge or instruction. Now, I ask you, gentlemen, as managers of Mr. McAdoo, if you will agree to that.
I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, but Mr. McAdoo will not release delegates committed to him.
Gentlemen, I tell you right now that I would rather be Cal Coolidge's dog than a Democrat.
Alabama! Alabama, on the 100th ballot, cast 24 votes for Oscar W. Underwood!
Look, we're talking about the Democratic nomination for the presidency. Now, we can get it for the senator if we don't let go now.
Charlie!
Yeah. Okay! McAdoo just released his delegates! Hey! All right! Get down there to the convention hall! Stop picking up those votes! We've got a whole new ball game! We can win it this time! Go on! This time we can get it! Get out of here! Go on!
We got McAdoo's delegates! I knew they'd have to break. Watch McAdoo disappear!
Oscar, I got another piece of good news for you. I just didn't want to announce. Smith says he'll turn his votes over to you if we can get you two more southern states.
Do you have any suggestions?
No, but I think he'd consider Georgia one of them.
Mm-hmm. Huh? All right, you ask the governor to give me 2 or 3 hours and get some people up here from the Georgia delegation.
I'll do it. Join Georgia delegation. By the way, get it?
Charlie?
Yeah?
Charlie, they announced the 101st ballot.
All right, send someone to see you right away. Will you come up here? I thank you. Oscar, they're going to be here right after next ballot. Let's go!
All right. Well, here we go, Alabama.
Alabama. Oscar.
24 votes for Underwood.
Yeah.
That Bill Brandon never gets tired. Arizona.
Arizona.
3 for McAdoo.
3
for Underwood.
Arkansas. 18 for Robinson.
Robinson. California, let us know, Oscar. How they're going to split for McAdoo or not?
All right, here it is. California.
McAdoo.
3 votes! Woo!
Yes, Charlie is out of the running. McAdoo is whipped.
We got him, Oscar.
Now, wait a minute. California.
One for Smith.
19 for Walsh.
Connecticut, Oscar. If we can get a majority in Connecticut, we got a real chance.
Colorado.
3 for Smith. 2.5 for Davis.
2.5 for Davis.
1 for Walsh.
1 for Walsh.
1 for Underwood.
Underwood. Any spot helps. Come on.
Connecticut. 1 for Davis.
1 for Davis.
Come on. 2 for Walsh.
2 for Walsh.
11 for Oscar Underwood.
Charlie, did you hear that?
Could be this time. It could be.
What?
Votes, Oscar. Davis has 316. That puts you, let's see, 183% over the total of the last ballot. Davis jumped 55%. Next ballot ought to be the last one.
I'm getting too old for this kind of waiting, Charlie.
Well, you'll get younger on the next ballot because McAdoo is all washed up and so is Smith. Right now it's just you and John W. Davis. I figure on the next ballot, all the favorite sons will disappear. Either that one or the one after that, they can't last.
You know, Charlie, I came very close to the nomination in 1912. I almost had it. When they came and told me that they couldn't get it, I said very simply, go ahead, withdraw my name.
Well, you're only 50 years old then.
Yeah. almost too young to be president of the United States. I would have been the first president to take my country into a world war. I often wonder how Wilson felt during those years, especially when I consider that the decisions he had to make would have been mine to make.
Yep. Just wait outside.
Oscar, two members from the Georgia delegation out there waiting to see you.
Now is the time to make a deal, Charlie. We want it on the 102nd ballot. What's the matter?
I don't know those two men, Oscar. But I can't help remembering that the Klan controls 85% of the Georgia delegation.
You think those men are Klansmen?
I don't know whether they are or not, but I do think it's time we start to look at ourselves pretty closely. I've talked to members of the Louisiana delegation. They had planned to come out for you, but they are thrown off by that speech that phony Johnston made for you. That speech attacking the Klan cost us the Louisiana vote.
I know a lot of these men, Charlie. They can't all be Klansmen.
Well, they aren't, Oscar. But they think that speech and our fight for the minority plank put a religious smell into the whole campaign. Well, these people are Catholics who hate the Klan, but they still don't want the party to make the Klan an issue.
It was our strategy to smoke McAdoo out. It worked.
Yes, it worked as far as it went. Maybe we ought to change our strategy when it can backfire. If that's all it is, strategy, I won't ask it, Oscar. I'll simply put it to you this way. Arithmetic doesn't have anything to do with morals or principles. So far, you've got about 230 votes you can count on. The next ballot, the Klan controls about 500 votes. You add those two figures together and you get a total. The nomination, if the only thing that matters, is the arithmetic.
Aren't you asking me how much I want to be president of the United States? Yeah. And you think I can be? Show them in.
Come in, gentlemen.
Evening, Senator.
Good evening, gentlemen. Come right in. Be seated, please.
Charlie Collins said you wanted to see us.
I will be frank, gentlemen. Governor Smith has pledged his support to me if I can count the Georgia delegation in my column on the next ballot.
Senator, we're going to be very, very frank with you. McAdoo isn't going to make it, and he knows it, and we know it. We're going to pull out from under McAdoo on the next ballot.
Well, we're in the swing vote your way, Senator.
Well, I'm very grateful for this offer, gentlemen. Then I may inform the governor that...
We weren't just talking about the Georgia vote, sir.
We were talking more about, let's say, 400 or 500 votes.
Just about enough to put you over the top, son.
Well, that is quite a large block of votes. You must want something for it.
Oh, no, we don't exactly want anything, sir. I find it hard to explain.
Well, you can try.
Let's put it this way, Senator. You're a Southern gentleman. You can understand the feelings of the South. You can understand how people down our way have strong feelings.
And when people have strong feelings, well, they're bound to have strong opinions. Personally, I'm not a member of the Klan, neither is Lawrence here, but we know lots of people who are, all lots of them, and well, some of them are decent, hard-working people. Maybe they go too far sometimes, but, look, the good Lord didn't put us on earth to judge our fellow men, so I won't judge them.
We're not asking you to do something that we wouldn't be prepared to do ourselves. I think most people know your feelings about the Klan. I mean, you're on the record, Senator.
Very strong record it is, too, sir. Very strong. You stand against the Klan.
And standing against the Klan as I do, You still feel that you can get me their votes?
Senator, whatever you think about the Klan, they are Christians willing to forgive and forget.
It's very Christian of them.
Oh, not that all of them feel that way, sir. Some of them are bitter, Senator. Very bitter. They say things like, we're going to tromp Oscar Underwood into the ground.
Well, that's just hotheads among them.
But you see, Senator, we feel the more responsible members of the Klan would look in favor on your nomination if you would...
Yes?
If you would pledge yourself, so to speak, not to single them out in the election campaign. So if you could find forgiveness or tolerance in your heart, I'm sure the Klan could find the same.
After all, we all Americans, aren't we?
Well, I guess that's about it, Senator. I don't expect the next battle to be the clincher, but the one after that will be, so... Well, you think it over, and we'll telephone you next hour or two during the battle, and you let us know.
You understand, Senator, we're not guaranteeing anything. Some of those hotheads just won't go along with you.
But like we said, the more responsible elements of the Klan are certainly willing to wait on your answer and take your word as a Southern gentleman of honor.
Thank you.
Over the last ballot, Davis is only up 31%. Now, if the percentages hold, we got...
Has that Georgia delegation phoned?
No, but they certainly will.
Their votes count now, don't they?
Oh, Oscar, they make all the difference.
Mr. Carlin, what would your best advice be now?
I don't know, Oscar.
Oh, come now, Charlie. What would you say, you yourself, without any regard for your position as campaign manager? I hereby appoint you a candidate. Now, as a candidate, what do you say?
That's not a fair question to ask.
Why not?
Because I'm not the senator from Alabama who will have to run for re-election if I don't get the nomination. I am not the potential candidate. I am not potentially the next president of the United States. I have nothing at stake when I decide. I believe in arithmetic. I believe what Holman Cummins told me about politics. The first function of a politician is to get himself elected. Everything else he does after that is a splendid redundancy. St. Underwood Suite. This is Collins speaking. Yes? Gentlemen from the Georgia delegation calling. They're preparing for the 103rd ballot. Oscar, you want to talk to him? Just a moment, please. These people can be vindictive. They can ruin you in politics. That was no idle threat. They can tromp you into the ground.
I think I'll go out and get some fresh air. Let me know how the next ballot comes out.
Sorry, the Senate has nothing to say to you. No, not now, or ever. That's right. You understand me?
Senator? Senator? Sir, you got a visitor.
What? What is it?
You have a visitor. It's Mr. Carl.
Oscar!
Charlie, how nice to see you. What a surprise.
Yeah, well, I just happened to be in the neighborhood and I thought I would just surprise you.
That's a good surprise, Charlie. How about a little bourbon? We'll strike a blow for freedom.
Yes, sir. Let's break the law.
Sit down, Charlie.
You know, Oscar, I didn't just happen to be in the neighborhood. Matter of fact, I come down here specially, thank you, to apologize to you.
Apologize? What for?
Because I want you to kick that Georgia delegation off in the face. I tried to hide it, but I failed. I served you badly. And I was wrong. The Klan hasn't become an issue in the election. It never will. I should never encourage you to take on the Klan. I made a mistake. And you paid for that mistake.
It was no mistake.
Oscar, you could have been president.
Lots of good men never got to be president, Charlie. They never even got to be one of the nominees of a major party convention. The measure of a man's achievements in life shouldn't be the highest public office held. Charlie, sometimes you do something. You strike a blow out of instinct, out of impulse, out of some unexplained feeling in the pit of your stomach. And that blow was right. It should have been struck. Even if every experience of your life up to that moment says that it's wrong, and everything afterwards confirms it. When you do a right thing, you feel good. And I feel it was right, Charlie. By George, I feel it was right. Charlie, don't end your life regretting an impulse that makes you feel good. Remember how you felt when you turned him down on the phone?
Yes, sir. Like I was 20 years old and had the world by the tail.
Doggone it, Charlie. No matter what happens in this world from this moment on, we were right. Now let's hold on to it. Now maybe we got sidetracked a little with that arithmetic. In spite of the arithmetic, in spite of everything, what we did was wiser.
Oscar Wilder Underwood, United States Senator from Alabama, paid a high price for his act of courage. He not only lost the Democratic presidential nomination, but he also lost his renomination for the Senate. He forfeited his political career in fighting the bigotry of the Ku Klux Klan.
These stories of past courage can teach, they can offer hope, and they can provide inspiration. But they cannot supply courage itself. For this, each man must look into his own soul.